Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Political Theory Colloquium of the Government Department, today co-sponsored by the Program on Constitutional Government. And our speaker is Hugh Liebert, who is an assistant professor in the Political Science Department, Social Science Department at West Point. He's a graduate of Harvard in 2001. He was an elegant host, philosopher, and bon vivant at Elliott House, and then he went to University of Chicago, and committee in social thought, where he got his PhD with his dissertation on Plutarch, and his book on Plutarch called Plutarch's Politics will be coming out soon from Cambridge Press. So his subject today is an introduction to the political philosophy of Plutarch. So Hugh Liebert.
All right. First, thank you for having me. Thanks, everyone, for coming. As Harvey mentioned, I went to college here, so it's a real treat to be back as a teacher. It's kind of nerve-wracking in ways. But the problem that kind of motivates my work on Plutarch actually is a problem that I started thinking about as an undergraduate and that sort of motivated me to get into political theory, which was basically, I arrived here at Harvard and realized that I had these attachments to my hometown, to my city, where I knew everybody. But I had some sort of attachment to the nation I belonged to, and then in some sense thought of myself as a human being belonging to this all-inclusive group of all human beings. And I wanted to understand what those different allegiances kind of required of me, and how they fit into each other, the tensions that might arise from them, and how they affected how I, you know, acted and thought about myself politically. And that it really is my first question, and it's the question that I discovered over a long period of time Plutarch thinks a lot about too. So I'm going to be trying to introduce us to political thought in Plutarch in such a way that we can see that he speaks to that issue. Just kind of where I'm coming from. Can I just ask really quickly, though, before I start, how many of you have read the paper before? All right. Sorry, that wasn't me. I'm not offended. I just wanted to make sure, because I'm not going to present it, and I didn't want to read through it if everyone has read the paper, but I'll go ahead and present that.
Read Plutarch.
I'm just repeating what you said. Hopefully a little bit more clearly and more concisely. You wrote a lot. Alright. So Plutarch's Lives were once read widely for insights into the fundamental questions of political life. They're not read widely today, at least not outside of classics departments. And that's despite the efforts of a lot of political philosophers, like Strauss, Arendt, Bernard Williams, Oakland, to kind of resuscitate ancient political philosophy and make it philosophically relevant again. So as a result of their efforts, the political thought of Plato and Aristotle, the rhetoric of Demosthenes and Cicero, the tragic and comic poetry of Athens, are all back on the table for us to think about, right? But Plutarch isn't really. And that presents an interesting question. Why does Plutarch stand apart from the rest of the reborn, right? These other philosophers who come back to life. I think there are a number of reasons, and I think they're worth attending to in an introduction to Plutarch's political philosophy, because it's not at all clear to many of us that Plutarch has a political philosophy. I'm going to suggest that he does, and I think that his political philosophy is something important to teach us for two main reasons. First, Plutarch offers a distinctive political psychology. He understands ambition, more literally the love and pursuit of honor in Greek philotimia, as the definitive political passion. That's a claim that still has some purchase in the present. Philip Pettit, Robert Faulkner, Sharon Krauss, all in different ways, and in ways different than Plutarch, have made something like that kind of case. Right? But I think it's the first reason that Plutarch is really interesting to us political theorists. The second is that Plutarch's political philosophy has something interesting to teach us about political form, which is a term I borrowed from Pierre Menon. On my reading, Plutarch suggests that the polis can be understood as a satisfying endpoint for ambition, even when a near-universal empire has extended citizens' horizons and attenuated the polis' autonomy. Combined, these arguments about political psychology and political form are of considerable historical interest. They suggest that Plutarch is a bit different than some of his contemporaries in the Second Sophistic, for instance. And these arguments are potentially of more than historical interest to us as we try to understand what happens to politics when sovereignty ascends above and descends below the political forms that have served for centuries as sites of political action. But I'm aware that might seem like a lot to put on Plutarch as he's known to us. So I want to start by addressing the reservations that we political theorists might have when approaching Plutarch's parallel lives. Then I'm going to dive into the text of one exemplary life, Lycurgus, in order to demonstrate how Plutarch presents his political philosophy. And finally, I'll conclude by saying more about what I think Plutarch's political philosophy meant in his own context and what it might mean to students of politics today. Okay, so first. Why don't political theorists read Plutarch's Lives? So Plutarch once had a wide range of enthusiastic readers, and as a result, it's possible for people like me who are really interested in Plutarch to assemble a very impressive array of endorsements. Right? You can think of it as like the blurbs that would go on the back of an edition of Plutarch's life. So just give you a kind of range, right? Montaigne was very fond of Plutarch. He said that he's a very astute psychological judge. He said Plutarch is the man for me because he gives us these moving portraits of statesmen in our lives. Shakespeare, of course, takes Plutarch as his guide to ancient character. Rousseau assigns the lives to Emile. He also attributes to Plutarch his love of liberty from reading Plutarch as a child. He says, quote, Plutarch was the first author I read in my childhood. He will be the last I read in my old age. He is almost the only author I have never read without gaining something. Shortly after Rousseau, the journaliste Madame Roland recorded in her memoirs that she used to sneak Plutarch's lives into church with her instead of a prayer book. We have a wonderfully charming paybook that Hamilton kept when he was an aide-de-camp to General Washington, where he read the lives of founders and took notes on them, right? And imagine himself that. And it took note in particular of some of the strange sexual customs, which is a kind of awkward thing. I was quite interested in my curtains. That, I think, gives us some sense of the spiritual significance that Plutarch's lives once had. And it was thanks to those ways of reading Plutarch that the protagonists of the lives, like Cato, Brutus, Publius, most famously, could rise from the dead and write these political pamphlets and participate in the rebirth of republicanism, not only in theory, but in deed. Revolutionaries were very much motivated by Plutarch. And Plutarch, even after the republican revolutions in the 18th century, continued to be very well read into the 19th century. By people like Nietzsche, who claimed that with 100 men who had satiated their souls with Plutarch, he could silence the noisy sham culture of this age. So the eminence of those endorsers suggests that our author might be someone to take seriously. But they also give us an initial measure of how Plutarch can be read. In the 16th and 17th centuries, the best readers of Plutarch were often astute political psychologists. In the 18th century, thanks largely to Rousseau, Plutarch acquired a republican political agenda. In the 19th century, Plutarch kept his political profile but switched parties. No longer an inspiration to republican revolutionaries, he was the ideal hero worshiper, happy to help those standing athwart the rising tide of equality. The Plutarch known to political theorists is, I suspect, still the Plutarch of the 19th century. He's little more than an admirer of great men, and he's looked on with something of a distaste he might feel for Carlyle. Something like that. He just seems kind of out of fashion. And I think it's that association with the hero worshippers. That's the first and probably most important reason why Plutarch isn't really well known to students of politics today. But there are other reasons, such as Plutarch's historical context. Plutarch lived from about 50 to 120 CE. He was, as a child, he went to see Nero on one of Nero's Greek excursions. He never participated in one of his and steel statues in Delphi. And Plutarch saw that in person. And he wrote most of his work under Trajan and Hadrian towards the end of his life. So he lived under the empire, but he didn't write about the empire. It wasn't like his contemporary Tacitus. He tries to enter to analyze the imperial regime with a few minor exceptions. Instead, he wrote about Roman politics under the Republic. In the parallel lives. They start with Romulus and they end with Antony. And when he wrote on Greek politics, he focused by and large on Greek politics under the Ottoman cities before Greece was conquered by Rome. Right, so those begin with Theseus and they run up towards Philippone when Greece falls under Rome. So that distance from the objects of his study in parallel lives makes Plutarch not very useful for historians who are interested in capturing what the actual historical truth of the situation was. And I think they contribute also to this sense among political theorists that Plutarch is something of a nostalgist and someone who is interested in just praising a past they doesn't really understand. Macaulay captured that sentiment very well when he said that, quote, Plutarch writes of liberty as monks write of love. some monks wrote really great stuff about love, but Macaulay didn't have a monk. So that's a second problem, this issue of historical context, now it relates to the politics of Plutarch's analyst. Third, there's the problem of literary form. Political theorists are accustomed to reading dialogues and treatises as works of political thought. The more adventurous among political theorists can even read plays and speeches and so on. Plutarch worked in those genres on occasion, but the genre that he really made his own, that he's most famous for, is the life, right, or what we call the biography. what do you do with that as a work of political thought? We've gotten accustomed to reading dialogues and, as in many other genres, but it's not really clear what one does with a life, much less a set of lives written in parallel, which is the form that Plutarch really innovated and made his own. So those are the three major problems political theorists face when they approach Plutarch. He seems a rather straightforward worshiper of heroes, writing at a time that obscures his insights into the heroes he praises, and in a form that makes his thought difficult to access. So I want to turn now and defend the accused, briefly, as 3 points, our potential hurdles. So I think properly understood, each of those impediments actually points to a feature of Plutarch's works that can make kind of appealing to us. So let me just speak briefly about that. In the first case, you don't have to spend a very long time with your lives to understand that Plutarch is definitely doing something other than worshiping heroes. Right? Every character in the lives is flawed in one way or another. Even the characters that Plutarch seems most to admire, like Cato the Younger, have major flaws that Plutarch doesn't hesitate to point out. So it's just, I think, from a very poor reading or no reading at all, really, that you get this impression that Plutarch is a worshiper of heroes, even though he is more inclined to praise than blame, as he explains on a few occasions. But even when Plutarch praises, he doesn't do that to show his readers that they should admire, but what qualities do and do not deserve their admiration, how he and his readers should admire them, and perhaps most importantly, how their political condition inflects and informs their ability to admire properly. In other words, admiration, much less worship, is not the goal of Plutarch's work, but an instrument and an object of study in laws. Second, it's true that Plutarch's placement among the second sophistic, that it is, you know, there's this movement from about 60 to 230, 250 or so, depending on what it ends. But this movement of Greek intellectuals who are interested in you know, Hellenizing Rome or Romanizing the Greeks. All right, Plutarch is among that crowd. That puts him somewhat outside of the kind of canon that political theorists conventionally read. But you know, arguably that's a weakness in the canon, not in Plutarch, because there are a lot of interesting questions that this movement raises that are politically relevant questions. Among them, you know, what does a Republican past mean within imperial politics? What does the city mean when the city loses its autonomy and has to exist within a much broader political entity? What does Platonism mean when it confronts a political situation that it had anticipated only easily? Those are very interesting questions that these kind of works allow us to understand. Third, lives or biographies ought to be viewed, I think, as an exciting new frontier for political thought. It's not clear why this literary form should pose impediments greater than the dialogue form, which you know, basically everyone working on Plato now understands that the dramatic and literary qualities of that are very closely related to Plato's political thought. Right? I don't think there's any inherent reason why the life has to be seen differently than that. And that's particularly true for writers who are working in the Platonic tradition, as Plutarch is, and therefore in light of the city soul analogy, where in the same way that one could look at a city's institutions and try to extrapolate some understanding of the citizens who you know, act in them themselves, so you could start with the soul, right, and try to extrapolate something about the city from that. If you were pursuing the city's soul analogy that way, the proper literary form to get after that, I think, would be the life, and that's what Plutarch uses. So Plutarch, as I read him, is the first, at least the first author whose works we have a lot of, fully to realize the political philosophical potential of biography. All right, so to see how he does that, I'm going to turn now to one really good biography in this work, in the parallel lives, Plutarch's Lycurgus. Okay, so Plutarch's Lycurgus is one of 128 works that we have of Plutarch's. If the most authoritative catalog that we have of Plutarch's work is to believe, the Lamprey's catalog, it's one of 227 that Plutarch once wrote. Again, he's a prolific author. And it's not only that he's prolific, but he doesn't give us a whole lot of help in discovering the high ground in that vast landscape, like where we should start. There's nothing in Plutarch that's quite like Plato saying that the Republic will be the discussion of the best regime and the laws the discussion of the second best regime. And there's nothing like the kind of dedicatory letters to the Prince of the Discourses where Machiavelli says they contain everything we learned. He leaves us more or less at our own devices in terms of figuring out a good way in to his work. Nevertheless, I think there are indications that the Lycurgus and Numa, this one pair of lives, is a particularly good place to start when studying Plutarch's political thought. And this for a couple of reasons. First, there are several pairs of lives where the theme of the lives is transparent, the reason those two people are joined together. So in the Alexander and Caesar, for instance, this is a study of conquest. In the Alcibiades and Coriolanus, it's a study of traitors. And similarly, in the Lycurgus and Numa, it's transparent that the theme is lawgiver. That's what Plutarch is trying to understand. And this is one of the loftiest themes in the tradition of Plutarch and Herod's, insofar as the moment of lawgiving was understood, is one in which political actors were most free from convention and most open to guidance from nature or the gods. The moment of lawgiving was understood to be the moment where politics and philosophy came into rather close contact. So that's one reason, the theme. Second, Plutarch was relatively unconstrained by history in composing these lives. For Plutarch, historicity is not the primary concern, right? But when he has historical sources, he does generally try to get the history right. Their cases will go against them because of some interest he has, but he generally has to follow them. In the case of Lycurgus and Numa, I mean, to our view, these are entirely mythical figures, right? And the sources that Plutarch has for guidance aren't as robust as they are in other cases, so he has a freer hand to shape the stories as he wants to. Third, the Lycurgus contains one of a handful of the life's programmatic statements, which are these moments when Plutarch reflects on what he's doing in writing the lives. So probably the most famous, I imagine everyone is familiar with, at the beginning of the Alexander, Plutarch says, don't get upset if you don't hear your favorite battle described in great detail, because I'm not interested in writing histories, I'm interested in writing lives. And when you write a life, you study the signs of the person's soul, even if these are very small, mad, and private. And there are several statements like that in the lives. Lycurgus has one of those, programmatic statements where Plutarch seems to reflect on what he's up to. But it's brief, elliptical, and largely unremarked in the scholarship on Plutarch, even though it's, to my mind, one of the most important for understanding what he's up to. So that's a third reason these lives are particularly important. Fourth, Plutarch seems very transparently to be dealing with the highest reaches of the political philosophy in these lives, insofar as he calls Lycurgus's Sparta, a philosophizing city. He compares it to Plato's best regime. And in the case of Numa, he says that Numa is a philosopher king. Right? So he's kind of engaged with the idea of the best regime in Plato. And lastly, and kind of related to that, Plutarch presents Lycurgus as a departure from the tradition of political philosophy that was represented to him by Plato and Aristotle. In fact, he seems concerned to rebut everything that Plato and Aristotle said about Sparta in the text of Lycurgus. And I want to begin there in terms of getting into the lives. And Lycurgus. So in Lycurgus, Plutarch announces his departure from tradition of political philosophy on a number of small points, right? So he calls his readers' attention to the fact that in Laws, the Athenian stranger had said that, you know, that Spartans are all these kind of decadent homosexuals, right? And he says that's not true. Actually, homosexuality was a very important educational institution. He said that Aristotle said that, you know, women ruled in Sparta, and it was a bad regime for that reason. He says that's not true. Women were actually controlled by Lycurgus. He remarks on Aristotle's criticism of Sparta for being secretly luxurious and having unconstitutional property. He says that's not true. It's actually even pristine and austere. That's what people praise Sparta say. So on each of these points, he tries to rebut what the political philosophers are saying. But on a more significant and philosophically important point, he wants to reject what they've said too, and that has to do with the question of the best regime. The political teachings of Socrates' disciples, for all their diversity on other points, have by and large agreed that the regime in which the wise ruled was best, the rule of honor lovers, was an inferior alternative, because as Plato put the critique of democracies, as Socrates in the public, lovers of honor seemed virtuous in public, but in private they were not virtuous. Insofar as you're oriented by honor and by the praise you give for public action, you can be virtuous when you're exposed to praise, but in private, when you're not exposed to praise, vice will kind of seep into the regime. That's critique of democracy. Plutarch's analysis of Sparta, by contrast, wants to say that a regime that promotes and channels the love of honor can benefit greatly from that passion, particularly when it's shaped by the political form of the city, the small community of the city. Plutarch, in short, sets out to rehabilitate democracy. And that marks a very serious departure, I think, from what Plato and Aristotle. All right. So, as I mentioned, Plutarch pursues that rehabilitation by a literary form rather different than Plato's dialogue or Aristotle's treatise or lecture. At first glance, the life provides philosophical arguments only rarely. Telling anecdotes are the coin of the realm. To study politics through lives requires that we learn to reason as Plutarch does through stories rather than arguments. And so I want to start in talking about Lycurgus of lawgiving by telling you a story, the Lycurgus that Plutarch tells. And the story is this. So Lycurgus is born the second son in the royal family. His older brother dies. And after his older brother dies, his sister-in-law, the widow, comes to him and says, I'm pregnant. like she says that she will reach a deal with Lycurgus, whereby she'll kill her baby and marry him, and he'll be king. Okay. And Lycurgus says, great, let's do it. But don't abort the baby. Don't mentor yourself in doing this. You know, it's all they did. So don't abort the baby. Deliver the baby, bring him to me, and we'll be done. And deal. And so she delivers the baby, brings him to Lycurgus, and then Plutarch describes this in the most dramatic way. Lycurgus lifts the baby up and says, behold, Spartans, a king is born to you. It aims at people's joy, care, lives. At a stroke, then Lycurgus relinquishes the Spartan throne and in his place installs people's joy, who's going to be a living memorial at the instant when Lycurgus' virtue and its effect on those who witness it more simultaneously would be. Okay, that's the first step. Now, for Plutarch, that story, or the experience of seeing that, that's the authority that allows Lycurgus to give his laws. Plutarch doesn't, in the first instance, attribute the lawgiver's authority to some power higher or lower than the lawgiver himself, whether the gods, necessity, or nature. Instead, the display of virtuous action itself is understood to command obedience and admiration. And that's a phenomenon that Plutarch analyzes in a bunch of different ways throughout his life. Some of the display of virtuous action, especially seen at close hand, carries a kind of authority with him. And Plutarch depicts this in the body of life, in the narrative of lives, and how the Spartans react to Lycurgus, and also, I think, expects his readers to react to the narration of Lycurgus' action in a way that resembles the reaction of the Spartan spectators admiring Lycurgus' high-mindedness and justice. Now, that first scene, though, doesn't affect all the spectators in Sparta in the same way. Plutarch shows us that the Spartan people who are there are ready to obey immediately. They're on Lycurgus' side. But there are also these other Spartans, the queen, the sister-in-law, and her retinue, who are much more cynical about this, and only see the effectual truth of this, right, so to speak, which is a great upsurge in popular opinion, right? Like Lycurgus is a proof of what he's called the chart, and he has this following element of the people. And they portray it that way to the people, right? They say that basically he's trying to win admiration and part of this long game, you know, to win the monarchy in Sparta. And it works, right? Eventually the people turn on Lycurgus, and he's forced into exile. So you can see in those two reactions to Lycurgus, Plutarch describing to us two extremes between which you can imagine a kind of virtuous mean. Right? On the one hand, you have this kind of worshipful praise that the people have. Right? They see something virtuous and immediately willing to follow it. Right? On the other hand, you have this cynical approach that the prince, prince of the royals and so on have, which is to say that this is only a political form, doing something virtuous. And in between, you can imagine, between the excess of worship and the deficiency of cynicism, you can see a virtue that Aristotle had named, which is the capacity to admire copy. Now, it turns out that in the narrative of life, there's a group of people in Sparta who represent that virtue, the capacity to admire copy. We're first introduced to them as the magistrates who are present at this initial scene where Plutarch saves Lycurgus saves Charilaus. They hold public offices. They admire Lycurgus, but they're not like the people in these kind of private hires. They're people who have positions of authority in the city. When Lycurgus returns from his exile, those men, who are now called the best, the Aristoi, the Spartans, form the means and ends of the revolution. Lycurgus approaches each of those men individually, addressing them as equals and co-partners in the revolution, and he gives each of them a public role to play. 30 of them march into the Agora at dawn. And when the sunrise comes up, we see that these figures, the magistrates, control the public space in Sparta. And they are initially installed as the first and most important, Plutarch says, of the Lycurgus's innovations, which is the Senate. Right? So the Senate in Sparta is not only a check or balance, but it enshrines a certain sort of character at the heart of Spartan political life, one defined by its reaction towards a striking display of virtuous action. Right, so the revolutionaries admire without worship or cynicism. They're moved to act politically in such a way that they receive praise for their action. Plutarch's narration of that reaction to Lycurgus' saving of Charilaus models a response his readers might have towards Plutarch's narration of that action. Lycurgus' first and most important reform ensures that the most prominent political actors in Sparta are philotimor, honor lovers. By analogy, we can imagine Plutarch's best readers gathered around the seat of power, ready to engage in Lycurgus' legislation. So the challenge that Plutarch sets for Lycurgus and his colleagues is to establish a timocracy that refutes Plato's critique of this regime. And the way they pursue that is to dissolve the distinction between people and senators, so that all of Sparta's citizens become philotimoi, capable of admiring in the right way. To that end, his laws turned toward the cultivation of the honor lover, the pleasures and pains that Socrates had said would undermine the democratic regime. First wealth, and then physical pleasures and pains themselves. So I mentioned we're more familiar, I think, with the legislation as it has to do with wealth. So like Hermes's lawgiving entails this radical austerity. There are all sorts of things that one could buy are excluded from the city, all sorts of luxury items. There's this wonderful reform of the currency, where instead of gold and silver coins, we have these giant stones that you have to use. And you know, it's interesting, there's not so much the details of the legislation there, but the way you can kind of see that responding to Plato's critique of democracy, that you know, it's a way for Lycurgus, first of all, excluding certain things that might allow you to translate into public authority your private wealth, but also making any transaction of public wealth so difficult, right? That currency is very illiquid, right? So it's so difficult that everyone has to see it, right? So there's this element of like private dealing is limited with these laws. And that's in a way an easy problem to solve as it's described to us. But the laws get subtler, I think, when they descend to the real root of the decay of entomocracy, which is the privacy of the flesh and its experience of pleasure and pain. It's not money, but pleasure and pain. That form of privacy would seem, I think, a kind of insurmountable stumbling block for democracy, insofar as that seems inherently private. Right, what our bodies experience in terms of pleasure and pain is inherently private. I mean, one way of thinking about it is that, you know, insofar as we have a body, we're always kind of like gaijis with this rim. I mean, there's something that we alone can experience that's accessible to someone else. Socrates' solution to that problem had been to educate people, right? To make the guardians understand that they're more soul than body, and through mixing music with argument, convince them, right, that their virtue was worth pursuing. Lycurgus's strategy is going to be very different. He's going to try to address democracy's fatal flaws, and really the root cause of the body, with timocratic remedies. He's going to come up with ways that fall short of education that respond to those problems. Okay, so a kind of emblem for that is to think about how he deals with the pleasure of taste, the pleasure of nice food. And as in most cases, Plutarch puts this argument with a story, right, as opposed to an actual argument. And so here's the story, and this is another kind of fun story from the Roman. So this is the story of Alcander. And the story is that when Plutarch, I keep alluding to Plutarch and Lycurgus, that's not just a slip of my tongue, but it's an argument I actually want to make in this paper a little bit later on. So I don't mean to do it quite yet. All right, so then the story with Alcander is, you know, that Lycurgus is now, has redistributed land and made the currency different and so on, but it's going after movable properties, and there's this revolt against him. An angry mob. Alcander is presented to us as a good-natured, spirited young man who gets carried away with the passions of the mob and pokes out Lycurgus's eye with a stick. Yeah. The mob at that point realizes that he's gone a bit too far. They feel ashamed. And they say to Lycurgus, here's Alcander, punish him as you will. Right? And they expect him to execute Alcander. But instead, Lycurgus says, Alcander, you're coming with me, you'll be my private assistant, you'll come home with me, right? And he shows Alcander how he lives at home, Alcander kind of becomes his understudy. And Plutarch describes this as a conversion experience, that once Alcander sees the kind of life, the quality of life, that moderation makes possible, he is still impetuous, but he's no longer a sort of violently impetuous young man. He's an impetuously moderate young man, right? He's got a converted person. For Plutarch, that's the founding story of the common messes in Sparta. The common meals for Plutarch are understood to be the way, really, that a democracy educates for moderation by allowing there to be virtuous examples that shape the character of the people who are observing them at close hand. And so he describes these scenes of old men giving up their meat on their plate to young Spartans, and then the kind of constant admiration of moderation that results from that. And so for Plutarch, that's the way that a democracy can be enshrined, admired, and taught. It's how a democratic regime can foster moderation. There's a similar kind of account of sexual pleasure, which I'm going to leave out for reasons of modesty and because I'm running out of time. And just say that just to notice in both of those cases where we as readers are seeing the same sorts of things that Plutarch's audience are responding to. And we're supposed to understand that there is something appealing about what might otherwise seem unappealing when we actually see what Lycurgus' home life looks like. Right? Lycurgus approaches physical pain rather differently. In part, his strategy there is to make the human body so immune to pain that pain doesn't register as a motivation anymore. And this is how Plutarch approaches all of these very harsh Spartan customs that we're all familiar with, you know, sleeping on reed beds outside and all the rest of it. And the other way that Plutarch approaches approaches that is to say that you know, that if you make honoring and shame and your exposure to praise and blame as constant as the body's exposure to physical pleasure and pain, which is an omnipresence always there as part of the way you experience the world, that this can you know, can shape people so that they're you know, they're more sensitive to that than to physical pain. And it gives us a number of stories there that I don't want to talk too much about. Last point about Lycurgus's laws before I move on to justify my slippage between Lycurgus and Plutarch is that just to notice that that all these laws turn on the power of vision. The suggestion is that in seeing this stuff firsthand, or you know, being present and seeing virtuous action, that commands this authority and sustains the regime. So for Lycurgus, the laws only work in a small community, in a city where everyone is seen. And you can see other people constantly. The small size of the city is really essential, I think, to its nature. And its hold on the honor lover arises from its experience of honor and shame, primarily through these seeing and being seen, both voluntarily and involuntarily in the city. And the intent of Lycurgus's laws in general is to minimize the invisible in the city, right? Bring everything out into the open as much as possible. All right. So, Plutarch presents Lycurgus as a lawgiver who can respond convincingly to the philosopher's critique of the city for the reasons I tried to lay out. But he puts that argument even further. He gets into this peculiar passage that I've alluded to where he calls Sparta a philosophizing city. And I want to read you where he says that. This is a quotation from Lycurgus. Lycurgus' design for a civil polity was adopted by Plato, Diogenes, Zeno, and by all those who have won approval for their treatises on the subject, although they left behind them only writings and words. Lycurgus, on the other hand, produced not only writings and words, but an actual polity, which was beyond imitation. And because he gave, to those who maintain that the much talked of natural disposition to wisdom exists only in theory, an example of an entire city philosophized that polity. His family rightly transcended that of all who ever founded polities among the Greeks. Well, that's weird, describing Sparta as a philosophizing city. One way to read that is just to treat it as a joke. Lots of interpreters do, and there's, you know, good precedent for that, because in the Pythagoras, Socrates makes a similar joke about the Sparta being philosophical. But I think it's worth at least trying to take Plutarch seriously when he describes Sparta that way. And you can do that by looking at the moments in Lycurgus's life where he does something that looks like philosophy, or just a reflection, right, as opposed to doing these great things that everyone sees and is influenced by. And when you do that, you see that Lycurgus has or represents a form of political philosophy that's radically political and radically agonistic. Okay, I'm going to say a little bit about each of those. First, Lycurgus's philosophy is radically political. I would just say it's not concerned with the natural order or the divine order as it exists apart from the life of the city. Plutarch brings that out in a nice way when Lycurgus is away from the city. He describes Lycurgus looking back on the city and compares Lycurgus to the god of Plato's Timaeus, who has just created a universe and is watching it in its first motions. Lycurgus's field of vision, as opposed to the Demiurgus, is filled entirely with political life. For him, the city is as the world would be to Plato's Demiurge, a perfectly self-sufficient whole whose creator can withdraw from it. From a distance, the whole has a certain stability and order. From inside, it's constantly moving, but in an orderly way. And the contemplation of that kind of a city, rather than the contemplation of the natural cosmos or of the forms, is the source of Lycurgus's joyful satisfaction. Okay, so that's the radically political part. Right? Lycurgus doesn't think about anything really outside the city, and he takes joy in the whole way that's analogous to how the god of Plato's Timaeus does. The internal motion and external order of the city bring us to the second feature of Lycurgus's philosophy, which is his agonism, more precisely, his discovery of truth through competition. Early in Lycurgus's life, when the queen's faction has forced him to flee the city, and before his revolution has begun, Lycurgus prepares himself to give laws by engaging in political philosophy. But he proceeds not through dialogue or discourses, but by putting lives in parallel in order to judge them. this is this programmatic statement that I alluded to earlier that I think is really important for understanding both this life and Plutarch's ethics. So this is a transition. Lycurgus set them, and that means the Cretans and the Ionians, such a different sense. Lycurgus set them in parallel in order to theorize about the differences in their lives and in their regimes. Okay, so that's the description of Lycurgus' intellectual. He sets these two cities in parallel in order to theorize about the difference in their lives and in their regimes. So for Lycurgus, the lives of men and their regimes are related to one another, as they are for Socrates and the Republic. You might even say that there are as many forms of humans as there are regimes. But where Socrates' typology of regimes crowns a theoretical elaboration of the best regime, which in turn has some relation to metaphysics, Lycurgus is putting them alongside one another in order to theorize seems sufficient unto itself. Lycurgus suggests that political phenomena can be adequately illuminated by arranging contests, oppositions that foster reflection on whether and in what ways one type of man might be superior to another. Lycurgus' city is built on public contests, the ceaseless motion of citizens opposing one another, the qualities of character the contests reveal and reward, and the intellectual virtues required for judging contestants. Spartan philosophy doesn't concern itself with anything beyond the city. It focuses instead on evaluating the virtues and vices, the deeds and misdeeds of men, particularly as they reveal themselves when men are set in opposition to one another. That sentence in the Lycurgus, the Spartan lawgiver arranging parallels in order to theorize about lives and regimes, should be understood, I think, as one of the programmatic statements that Plutarch gives us about his own project. As Lycurgus engages in a radically political form of philosophy, so Plutarch in the Lives concerns himself almost exclusively with political life. As Lycurgus philosophizes and enables the city to philosophize by arranging contests, so Plutarch writes Lives in parallel. In other works, Plutarch practices philosophy as we know it from Athens and elsewhere, but the Lives are a different sort of enterprise. They're Spartan philosophy. So, as such, Plutarch's Lives extend and depart from the tradition of political philosophy he had inherited. Like Plato and Aristotle's political philosophy, Plutarch's took as its focus the life of the polis. But whereas Plato had expressed his political philosophy in dialogues and Aristotle in written lectures, Plutarch pioneered a literary form of his own, Lives written in parallel. This genre allowed Plutarch to place statesmen at the center of his inquiry into politics and allowed them to appear in their native element, not in unaccustomed dialogue with more capable philosophers, nor waiting in the wings of lectures focused on laws and institutions, but in the flush of action and the speech proper to men of action. Life also expanded the realm of action and speech accessible to the observer, breaking down the distinction between public and private by opening for evaluation great statesmen's intimate, unguarded moments. Plutarch pitted pairs of statesmen so exposed in competition for his readers' approbation and judgment. The effect was a literary renaissance of the visible community in which citizens were mutually known, capable of evaluating one another, and ambitious to win one another's praise. Plutarch acted as the Lycurgus of that city, right, as you see in his parallel lives. So that, I hope, justifies my earlier position about Plutarch and Lycurgus, because that's what I think fundamentally Plutarch is doing in the lives. My think Lycurgus is really a good way to get into the project. Okay. Now, I want to conclude just quickly by saying, first of all, I know there are a whole bunch of questions that one can ask about the lives, but that discussion of that entry doesn't touch on at all, right? So I haven't talked about Lycurgus' partner in the pair, Numa. I have a chapter in my book about that. I'd be happy to talk about it later. I haven't talked about the relation between the Lives of Italia. I haven't talked about Athens in any way. We talked about a number of Lives of Athenians. And there are a number of other questions as well that you can ask. But I just want to give us a kind of initial entry into how we might read these parallel lives as works of political philosophy. So I want to conclude by saying briefly what I think that project, as I've described it, particularly the parallel lives as a kind of latter-day Lycurgus, might have meant in Plutarch's own historical context, and then just allude very briefly to what it might mean to the kinds of things we're interested in today. So first, Plutarch in his historical context. I think one of the first instincts we might have about Plutarch when we approach him in the way that I suggested, and when we take account of the fact that that Plutarch, he lived by and large in Cherdia, in a small Greek city quite far away from Athens and Rome, and a number of the other important centers that he could have lived in. He lived in his polis. His lives of Romans focused on Republican figures, not the empire, to suggest that maybe the greatest Rome had to offer was left behind when the regime transitioned into the empire. he praises only Greeks from autonomous cities, right? Suggesting that maybe something that Greekness has faded, right? Once the Autonomian cities has been precluded by the conquest of Rome, right? So for all of those reasons and probably many more, you might want to view Plutarch as a kind of revolutionary, right? Either as a Republican or a Greek separatist, but in any event, as someone who's against the empire. That's probably not the best way to view Plutarch. And for a bunch of reasons, and here I'm relying on a bunch of Plutarch scholarship that by and large who follows this way of interpreting that. First, in the regime that Plutarch is writing under the empire, it's not against the law to praise the old Romans and Greeks. Far from it. Right? Everyone praises the Roman Republic and the Greek cities. This is as much a practice done by Romans themselves as it is done by Greeks. There's nothing inherently revolutionary about that. There are limits, right? I mean, you can be persecuted by Domitian if you praise in the wrong way, these kind of Republican figures. But so long as you observe the limits, you can talk as much as you like about the sorts of things Plutarch talks about. There's nothing inherently revolutionary in the subject of what he's doing. Second, by the time Plutarch writes, Rome has arguably incorporated the Greek provinces fairly well. Many influential positions in the imperial administration are open to Greeks. You can be a senator in the imperial regime. You can hold many other offices as well. You can even be emperor. You don't have to be a Roman to be an emperor, right? It's a long time since Tacitus is a secret of the empire that the emperors can be made elsewhere than Rome. That's been let out, right? It seems as though the kind of ambitions of political people from the provinces are accommodated in the way in the regime of Plutarch's writing. Third, Plutarch's own life seems to testify to the harmony of Greece and Rome. Right? Plutarch isn't a disgruntled revolutionary intellectual kind of plotting the revolution, in his little home in Cherene. Quite the contrary. He has all sorts of friends among the Roman and Roman League, both among the provincials and actual Italian Romans. He has wonderful dinner parties at home. We get this vivid picture in his works, in the lives, especially in the Moralia, where he has the life of the bon vivant, who has these wine parties, talks to his friends, right? The kind of robust and rewarding private life that Plutarch has. So looking at that, and he's also honored, by the emperors as well, as we can tell. Well, there's some dispute exactly how he's honored. Looking at all that, you might think that Plutarch's life testifies to the fact that Roman provincials are quite comfortable under the Greek provincials are quite comfortable under the Roman Empire. Nevertheless, Plutarch does offer us lots of evidence that there are things that you can't do under the Roman Empire that Plutarch suggests that he might like to do. For instance, you have to account, he says, and here I'm drawing on an essay in Moralia, it's very famous for giving political advice to a young Greek man who wants to enter into political life. And Plutarch says to him, it's good to enter into the political life of the cities, but you have to remember that you always have the Roman boots hovering over your head. There's some dispute in the literature about whether this means the governor's shoes or the boots of the Roman soldiers. But in any event, there are Roman shoes up there, right, that you have to be aware of. And he says that if you talk the wrong way, you stir up mobs, or at least talk the great battles of the Greek past, that you will be punished, you can be killed by the Romans for talking inappropriately. So among all the things that the Greek intellectuals can do, the one thing that they can't do, and that they're very much aware of, Plutarch especially, is they can't lead truly autonomous cities. And so to engage in a political project that seems to suggest that there's something good about the autonomy of Greek cities, and that it gave rise to a certain sort of individual that's worthy of our attention and our praise, potentially, does have more of a, at least potentially problematic character than this is the picture of Plutarch is seeing him as basically totally at home in the Roman Empire suggests. Plutarch, incidentally, writes about all of the battles that he says you can't talk about in public in wars. He also goes out of his way to praise the Roman emperors who preserve Greek autonomy under the empire. Right? So like, he generally doesn't approve of Nero. He says many mean things about Nero in the course of his writings. But he gives us this one really remarkable passage in the essay in the Moralia in the Place of the Divine Vengeance, where Plutarch's being Nero, and that's not an intentional slur, is being punished in the afterlife, and he says that a god realizes that Nero freed Greek cities, and then he lets up a little bit on the punishment. So Plutarch definitely seems to be an advocate of as much autonomy as possible for the Greek cities, even in this horizon of empire, if it's not a revolutionary. And I think probably the way he teaches us to think about politics and lives is meant to facilitate that kind of a practical political agenda for his immediate readers in his historical context. right, so not anti-empire, but in favor of more rather than less autonomy for the Greek cities within the empire. What might that mean to us today, this kind of, like, this kind of a way of thinking about politics? I think there's room in Plutarch's life to start to work out a theoretical account of political form, by which I mean the way that our allegiance to the city, the nation, and the empire, these more or less exclusive ways of you know, orienting our politics, how they relate to each other, right? And I think in the best view of the Roman Empire, as Plutarch presents it to us, he saw Rome to be a regime that allowed each of those levels of political allegiance to express themselves simultaneously. That one could be a proud Greek citizen, participate in local politics, as Plutarch did, could serve in a number of nationally important, right, kind of Greek Hellenic institutions, as Plutarch also did as a priest at Delphi, and serve in some sense in the empire as well, with all of those different forms of allegiance sounding in a kind of harmony. However, Plutarch does seem to suggest, too, that in a situation where sovereignty and autonomy is located at the most inclusive of those levels, that the levels lower down are going to be threatened in some way. And he wants to insist that emphasizing the root of this thing, the city, is extremely important in a situation where the empire is ascendant. Now, Plutarch doesn't articulate that, again, in the theoretical register. His goal is to you know, bring back to life, so consider them the lives that city shape, in the hopes that the literary display of these virtues and vices can impress his readers even at a distance, as forcefully as the firsthand perception of their characters impress their contemporaries. And you could say, in some sense, the Plutarch project seems to have succeeded insofar as he had this vast influence, you know, laid out with all these impressive endorsements that his work gets. Insofar as this issue of how to think about political form, how to think about the nation under the, you know, prospect of an all-inclusive human community, is something that we're wrestling with, I think this way that Plutarch gives us to think about politics, the focus on a different level of allegiance, might be particularly relevant. We might, in particular, take a new kind of attentiveness to the city, the root of that, from Plutarch's works, as he seems to stress this really important issue. Okay, so I'll stop there.
Thanks very much, and for a comment, we now turn to Jacob Abalakia.
So, thanks. I'm going to do a little bit of recapitulation and then turn to some minor questions before ending with what I take to be my biggest question coming away from this. I read this with sort of great excitement, not only because it was written with a great deal of intelligence and humor, but also because it poses some important questions that remain under-theorized within history of political thought and political theory. All of us who study the ancients have asked ourselves at one point or another why our heroes read Plutarch, but we never do. Having now studied political thought across three universities and three different departments, I can confirm Professor Liebert's assertions about the neglect of the Chironian, with the possible exception of the literary Sea Caucus in the Cambridge Classics Department, where they do read him from time to time. But historians, theorists, and certainly philosophers are guilty of neglecting Plutarch almost wholesale. I found Professor Liebert's, that was, as soon as I picked up the paper, that was the question I had, and it was answered, and that made me very happy. I found Professor Liebert's explanation for why it was so almost entirely convincing. Now, I'll restate some of his points, and in doing so, try to ask some questions meant to clarify and push him a bit further. Professor Liebert deals with what seems to me to be the greatest and most pressing point first, the bold and obvious tendency of Plutarch to write about great men. Plato, and especially Aristotle, seem just right for today's social scientific institutionalism. We could argue over the details of the Athenian constitution all day, and frequently do, because such a conversation reflects the sort of arguments our colleagues have about the mechanisms of representation, etc., in our own society. Plutarch does not make it so easy. He writes about dead white men and seems, at least at first blush, to think that the deeds of old, dead, rich men are the proper study of politics. Oh my. In addition, Plutarch is untimely. We squirm a little bit when a peripatetic tries to reconstruct 5th century democracy from his perch in the 320s. What use, then, can we have for the writings of someone a full 500 years after the fact about which he wrote? It sort of seems like taking Hilary Mantel seriously about the psychology or even the greatness of Thomas's More and Cromwell. And if you ask any early modernists, they don't do that. Lastly, there is the issue of form, which I think is the least of the issues here, but does present a pleasing paradox. In an era when the biographical fallacy that the most important thing for understanding a work is the biography of the person who wrote it is the reigning vulgarity in our literary criticism, we seem least interested in biography as an art form, or at least a form of political writing. I think both the second and third problems, the sort of historical oddity and the formal issue, point to some undigested difficulties of certain historicist methods in our field and other humanistic disciplines. We historicists are uneasy with what we take to be bad history, and we do not have the good faith to read it as great literature. For all these difficulties, Professor Liebert has, even in this short format, made a persuasive case for the importance of Plutarch to our discipline. Ours is not a classical age, it is not a golden age, and I wonder if it is even a silver age. It is thankfully not a dark age, and that makes it rather close to Plutarch's own time. We feel, like him, out of step with the political forms in which we live. Professor Liebert does not say this explicitly, but Plutarch is, in a sense, the perfect post-colonial political theorist. His anxieties about rule, culture, and influence speak to our own. His understanding of the imbalance between hegemonic center and periphery hold up a Roman mirror to our own forms of universalism. All this seems very right to me. Professor Liebert points out that Plutarch's provincial position sets him apart from his near contemporary Tacitus. Next to Plutarch's inventive theoretical struggles with the possibilities of political freedom in light of the actuality of Roman imperium, Tacitus's subtle republicanism seems almost idealistic. By placing political freedom so far in the past, Plutarch makes it an object of philosophical contemplation rather than a political objective, if I understand Professor Liebert's reading correctly. We might thus fruitfully compare Plutarch to another near contemporary, Flavius Josephus. Josephus is more truly a subaltern writer than Plutarch, writing in an adopted Greek. And the consequences of Eudaiocapta were in many ways more radical than that of Graeciocapta. Yet, I wonder if Josephus might not suggest a parallel life to Plutarch, a thinker and historian trying to deal with the present through the past in ways difficult, if suggestive, for the modern reader. I have, as those, some in the room know, I have a particular obsession with Josephus, so I won't go further. But I do think that both Plutarch and Josephus reorient us to how we might approach minor figures in the canon. Their boringness or their weirdness makes them, I think, fruitful in certain ways. And especially, maybe it's just the second century. The first and second century have a particular historical import for us, but I'll leave that there. Professor Liebert tantalizes us with a glimpse of the sort of close reading his book promises to include through a brief discussion of Plutarch by Lycurgus. I won't recapitulate the points he made. I'll just highlight another interesting Plutarchan characteristic, which I take to be in the background here. Sparta, the real historical Sparta, was an object of great interest for the historiographers, sophists, and Socratics of the classical era. Many of them, especially Plato and Xenophon, used Sparta as a sort of ideal type, changing the real Sparta into a theoretical shorthand which was good to think with. So we have the first movement, which is taking actual Sparta and turning it into idealized Sparta. In Plutarch, who is writing a history of Sparta with the ideal Sparta of the philosophers in mind, we get a new type of ideal Sparta. One is interested in a philosophical debate with Plato as it is in representing facts on the ground in the 8th century BC. So the ideal Sparta of the Socratics gets turned into a supposed history of Sparta, which is in some ways called history or biography, but has been so transmogrified by contact with the political theoretical tradition that we're really fooling ourselves if we try to read it as history, and instead we should just embrace the fact that there's a tremendous amount of philosophical intertextuality going on here. I think this is a really subtle achievement of Professor Liebert's that even many credentialed classicists miss when they dismiss historical evidence from Plutarch. The parallel lives are not universal or natural history. Both forms which were being written contemporaneously in the first and second centuries, they are a form of philosophical commentary in dialogue with earlier thought. When we begin to understand Plutarch's Sparta in the way we might Plato's Magnesia, new problems and questions open up, not least the relationship between texts in the parallel lives. Is there an architectonic in Plutarch? Do we just sort of match the texts to maybe Platonic or Xenophonic parallels, or is there a structure in which we have to read them? That was a question I had. What of the connection of the biographies to Roman, specifically Roman moral and historiographical and ethical traditions of exempla, which seems to be a sort of unspoken presence here? We have a Greek taking very seriously the sort of things that Romans thought of as their sort of ethical heritage, the taking of an example. And indeed, what have we got to say about the connection between Greek and Roman ways of thinking historically and theoretically? This was an explicitly stated problem for first century Romans BC, and Professor Liebert makes me think it might be an implicit problem for Plutarch. I'll leave that there. Let me close with what I take to be my most serious question at the end of this, even after the thought-provoking paper. Does not one presumption of the modern reader do more harm to our ability to read Plutarch than all the others mentioned above? Is not Plutarch the most susceptible of authors to the charge of being interested mainly in the liberty of the ancients over that of the moderns? In a sense, Professor Liebert has defended Plutarch against being an author of great men at the cost of confirming him as the paradigm of a certain type of ancient, one interested in the liberty within the city. If this is so, we risk being left with Plutarch, whose project structurally mirrors our own, the sort of displacement and discomfort within our political reality, but whose content remains out of date as ever, because where he still had a Chaeronea to return to, it's not clear that we have the possibility of that sort of action. You had a sort of encomium to action, which I think is right, because as long as the Greek tradition had existed, praxis, action, was connected to bios, life. And to write about a life is to write about a form of acting. Unfortunately, and I mean here I risk heading into trendy territory, there's a sort of problem with acting in the modern era. And so I wonder, you made Plutarch into a sort of Arendtian character, and the very problems that Arendt and others have found with acting in the modern age, and indeed the problem with the category of bios, the sort of rich, active life, seem to me to prove really problematic for Plutarch. I suspect you have an answer to that worry as well, and I look forward to hearing it.
Thank you. That's great. I see that you've written this down, which is great, so I can ask you for the back.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Thanks. Those are all really great suggestions. Yeah, I would like to pull off those lines. Can I open it up to questions? I'll have a chance to talk to you afterwards.
Tom Cleveland for Boston College. So I enjoyed that. And my question for you is, I just want to clarify the connection and the connection to Socratic philosophy, as you understand it, and the difference that Plutarch has. So some of the things you said about Plutarch's political philosophy or Spartan philosophy, you could say about Plato and Aristotle, that they begin from within the political point of view as statesmen understand themselves and speak about those matters. But in the case of both Plato and Aristotle, despite their differences, there's some kind of ascent to a natural viewpoint above the political viewpoint. But you also emphatically said in the case of Lycurgus, there is no ascent, there's no natural viewpoint outside of the city. Now, is your claim about Plutarch that he, like Lycurgus, remains within the city as emphatically as Lycurgus does, or is there some kind of a sense akin to what Plato and Aristotle accomplish in some other way? So is it that emphatically political or not?
Yeah, that's great. Yes, it's that emphatically political.
Okay.
That's how I read it in short. So I think you're right to say that, like Plato and Aristotle, Plutarch starts from the perspective of the statesman.
Uh-huh.
The difference is that he stays entirely within that horizon. In the lives.
Yeah.
So there's okay. You know, these other works where he, you know, very abstract works on like how to understand Plato's Timaeus, you know, what happens at his, you know, lots of works on the soul, all sorts of works, you know, on like the theology of Delphi, In the lives, though, the orientation of the project is to take the statesman view and stay so entirely within that that there's never any ascent. The most ascent you get is like Lycurgus is being out of the city and looking only at the city, right? And that's it. And so Plutarch, I think, wants to experiment with that and see if it's possible to, you know, give a coherent account of politics that is much more radically political than the one he had inherited from Plato and Aristotle.
Yes, question which I tied to the Hobbes question. First, so it's interesting because Lycurgus, his Plutarch discussion, Lycurgus and also Numa come right after his discussion on the boundaries, the true boundaries, the thesis, and Romulus. The question is, it seems for you, you present Lycurgus as the man after Plutarch's heart, in the sense that he is a real founder, unlike the historical founder in the order of time.
Yeah.
But for Plutarch, how does he view the achievements of Theseus and Romulus in comparison with the achievement of Numa?
Yeah,
how does he make a comparison between
the
two? And also, a question added on to this, what's Plutarch's attitude towards monarchy as a form of government?
Thanks. So first, Theseus and Romulus comes, in some sense, is prior to Lycurgus and Numa chronologically. It's certainly prior in terms of, you know, how we present these things quite reasonably, right? It seems like the founders come before lawgivers and the traditions are printed that way. It's not how Plutarch presents it, though. He actually presents the Theseus and Romulus by saying, it's kind of like self-effacing, kind of humorous, like, you know, I've done the Lycurgus and the Numa. That was really hard. I wonder how far back we can go, right? And then he says that in the Theseus and Romulus is going to try to make myth look like history. That's his kind of. But that doesn't address your question. Your question is like, how do we understand the Theseus and Romulus relative to Plutarch's overall intent, right? I'll give you like my start and answer, and I'm not sure this is totally definitive. Theseus is the founder of Athens, and Romulus is the founder of Rome. Lycurgus is the earliest Spartan we have. So insofar as I'm right to identify Plutarch's project with Sparta, Lycurgus is really, for all intents and purposes, the first figure who's going to lay that out with the most clarity. Romulus, Rome and Athens play a different role in Plutarch's thought. Just really briefly, and there's a very short version of a very long argument, right? As I understand Rome, it generally has something to do with bringing different people together and this idea of working out a universal form for Plutarch. Which is an element of his literary project as well, because after all, he doesn't write comparisons of only Greeks to Greeks, he writes Greeks to Romans, and the Romans he's exploring are these ones who are involved in this large project that he seems to think is telescoped in Romulus's project of founding the Romans, and not, by the way, in Numa's, right? Athens, for him, presents a similar sort of problem as Rome, insofar as you have a founder and then a lawgiver, who in part is trying to correct some of the errors of the founding. A lot of Plutarch's interest in Athens focuses on how philosophy relates to politics. This is a much more prominent theme in the Solon than it is in the Theseus. The Theseus, he explores some themes that will come up later in the Athenian lives, like how a great individual relates to Demos, for instance. This is a very important theme. The way that Theseus doesn't really fit in the regime he founds as a founder, these are some things. On my reading anyhow, the Theseus isn't quite as determinative for Plutarch's overall project as Romulus would be or something like that. The interesting stuff in Athens comes up with Solon and with the subsequent lives. Anyway, that's a start of an answer. That's not a full answer. The second question was about,
Modern,
right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Yeah, so at times Plutarch takes a more or less Platonic line, you know, in saying that a philosopher king is the best you can do, right? He says that in Numa. For instance, he praises other, you know, monarchical figures like that too. But these figures, you know, fail by and large in Plutarch's narration of them. I mean, so he wants to hold out like the category of there being a philosophical monarch who might, in some sense, solve the problem. But because of this fundamental political orientation that he's taking in his letters, there's much more skepticism, I think, about that possibility than there is in kind of like ultimate affirmation.
So I found the aspect of your I wanted to see if I could get you to connect a little bit more two aspects of the talk. One is sort of the puzzling question of reads Plutarch, and the other, this particular interest you have in Plutarch as talking about, I think it was called post-colonial by the respondent, but anyway, universal politics and reflecting on the polis. Being a Canadian, sort of a country as just as it is unambitious, I've read all these American founders' biographies around the same time in college and read Plutarch, and so, and they were all, I just sort of arranged them all, you know, Lincoln, Fabius Maximus, it was all just, to me, they're all just characters, and, but it occurs to me that Americans still, it's a little bit politicized, but Americans still are really, gaga over their founders. They read all these biographies and see them on the bestseller lists.
Yeah.
Even really trashy ones like Bill O'Reilly. And so I wonder, I mean, could you have a modern Plutarch write up the American founders and that sounds like an interesting thing to do, people do that. And what would the difference be though? Because it occurs to me that part of your argument, or maybe it's in the argument, is that the Romans' view of the Greeks was maybe as being culturally superior but politically inferior, but Plutarch's view seems to be that, I don't know, there's some parity. They're both politically impressive. Doesn't seem to be a clear preference for Greek philosophy. I don't know how that works with the American founders.
Thanks, Rory. So you're absolutely right that biographies are very popular today. I mean, that's clearly true. And not only like written biographies, I mean, biopics are very popular. And so there seems like this is a very, you know, a kind of like, I mean, middlebrow, but not only middlebrow, way of like thinking about politics, yeah? And it's interesting to me that it seems like, for some reason, it's left at the middlebrow, and it's not, you know, reflected on properly by people who are trying to understand, you know, political phenomena. It's kind of curious.
Presidents say they read them.
Yeah, that's right. So statesmen and people who are, you know, citizens read biographies quite a lot. There's a very large biography section in Barnes & Noble, right? I mean, this is definitely a popular form. What's rarer, and this is, you know, so anyway, so that's right, and so what I'm talking about really is just the political theorists, this very rare, weird species of, you know, students of politics, right, not the citizens and citizens as well. But even there, what's interesting about the influence of biography is the idea of a parallel biography, which is, you know, that's, I mean, we have four unparalleled biographies from Plutarch, but most of his biographical work focuses on writing these parallel things, which are parallelized between Greek and Roman, right? Usually there's some kind of preface to it, and there's a comparison that he himself wrote at the end of them. You know, that form isn't widely, you know, imitated. It's not very, I mean, Plutarch has a vast influence on the writing of biography, you know, from Boswell up until the present, right? But in that form, the parallel form, isn't very widely imitated. And it would be a really interesting thing to think about. What would the contemporary equivalent of that be, right? And I floated this with some friends from Quebec. If you have like a Quebecer statesman versus, you know, Anglo-Canadian statesman, something like that would get the kind of like resonance of what's at stake in drawing this kind of parallel between
Kennedy.
But I don't know what that would be in the American tradition, right? But you need something like that to get the kind of resonance of the parallel.
I should make it so from the State Department. I was fascinated by this paper, this one paper. I work in Italian Renaissance, and especially the 15th century, which is the great Plutarchian century, when they rediscovered Plutarch, they translated into Latin, and so on. And I would say he's probably the number two author of the 15th century after Cicero. So, and it's interesting to me because so many of the aspects that you're pulling out of your reading of Plutarch, exactly what they pulled out, especially the episode at the beginning of the life occurs when he accepts the baby of King Nicolaus as the legitimate heir. That's chosen as an example of the charismatic quality of virtue. Right? The humans are all pushing the idea of virtue as the way to reform the state. And they also pick up this idea. And one reason why we're actually in my class, we're reading, Thomas More's Utopia. And it's very well known that, that More's Utopia was inspired to some extent by the life of Lot Curtis. But one of the things that, that they pick up on is the Platonism of Plutarch, which they understand to be about the plasticity of human nature. But the Aristotelians accept human nature as it is and try to manage it. And they're more realistic in one sense of that word. Whereas the Platonists really believe that institutions can change human nature. This is why they latch on to Lycurgus and the Spartans in general. Because the Spartan regime shows that human nature can be improved. And that's one of the things that the humanists are very eager to do. They love Agesilaus. And Agesilaus is always contrasted with the Roman dynasts of the first century BC, you know, Marius and Sulla and Caesar, who are generals who cannot control their ambition, who tear Rome apart. Whereas Agesilaus, who's conquering Asia like an Alexander the Great and all that, is, gets the call from the city to come back, right? And he leaves his conquests and his tremendous personal power in Asia and comes back and serves the city, sits down at the mess with the other guys, and they just and he doesn't claim any special privileges, even though he's the most powerful man in the world. 3 weeks before, well, a month before. So I mean, and the humanists love that because it makes it's an example of how virtue, if it's properly supported by institutions, can improve human nature. And but the thing is, there's a couple of things that interest me that I wanted to comment. One is this idea of the theoretical versus the biographical, the theoretical versus the real life. Of course, that's one of the big themes in Cicero's Republic, the Republica, where Cicero says the Greeks are great at theory, and Romans are great at providing actual examples of, you know, good government. I think that Plutarch is playing with that, but in an interesting way, because he's making the Greeks the example, at least in Lycurgus' biography, of exemplary practice as opposed to theory. My question I wanted to ask you, you know, since we're largely in this room, except for me, as a political theorist, the immediate desire is to theorize Plutarch and to see what could say to our time and how we can make a political theory of Plutarch. But maybe that's not what he has in mind. You know, maybe he doesn't really want to be the theorist like Plato and Aristotle. He wants to, he has a different way of addressing his audience, he has different purposes in mind. He wants to make people virtuous. He doesn't necessarily want to provide a theory of good government.
Yes. Yes. I agree with you. He doesn't want to apply a theory of good government. I think you're absolutely right to worry that trying to theorize Plutarch is somehow untrue to what he's doing. That's right. The challenge is, I think, to capture what he's suggesting about politics in a way that does justice to the way he presents it, and still has some way of, you know, of speaking about it in a theoretical register. But that's partly justified by what he does too, because when he presents, like at the beginning of the Pericles, for instance, about the he's kind of explaining this charismatic effect of virtue, and he says the really remarkable thing about lives as opposed to statues is that when you see a display of virtue, you are moved after you inquire into it to imitate it. Right. And similarly, in the Lycurgus sentence that's so critical, you know, my reading on it, that he sets them in parallel, you know, it's in order to theorize, right, and then to understand and imitate in some way, because he would absolutely do. So I think even in writing lives, Plutarch, you know, kind of characterizes his reader as someone who isn't going to just sit back and admire. They really try to understand why this particular person did what they did, and what the, you know, the political conditions they were under affected the action. And that's not exactly political theory in the sense of like working out, you know, a set of institutions or whatever that corresponds to his insight into morality. But it's also not, I think, exactly history. I mean, it's more of a theoretical practice, and that is the word that Plutarch uses for it too. than anything else.
But, you know, I think he wants people to be virtuous. I think that he wants to inspire people to virtue, which in fact he does throughout the entire history of the reception of Plutarch. That's what Rousseau's getting out of this, what he's reading. He's inspired, he's thrilled with the virtuous actions. He wants to know what conditions would have to prevail. And there's where you go theoretical, in order to bring the ability to act that way back.
Yeah, so I agree completely that he wants to inspire, that's kind of, in a way, the end of the whole project, the goal of it, is to inspire people to virtuous action. I think the only part where I would put the emphasis a little differently is I think there actually is a lot of ambiguity in how he presents these characters that requires some kind of reflection in order to resolve, and that the Plutarch is very conscious of putting this reader in that position. A really great example of how he does that is just in the parallel form of lives, right? Mm-hmm. So he puts a Greek next to a Roman. They obviously have some similarities, right? It's a very, you know, obvious when we pay attention to them that, you know, the life of Alexander is written with a view to the life of Caesar and vice versa. So the parallel is set up, and you're asked to evaluate their virtues relative to each other, rather than just sitting back in the mind. And then on top of that, he writes this synchrises, it's translated in comparison, which is a very poor translation. It's actually the act of judgment at the end, where Plutarch casts you he gives you a vote, basically, and says, all right, now you have to pick which one of them was better. Who won, right? And he goes through a kind of rhetorical exercise of making the case for one of his protagonists and then going to the other, and almost never making it clear who you really should vote for, right? And so the end of that is absolutely making people virtuous in some way, but there's a lot of intellectual activity.
We know that when people read these and discussed them afterward, were these meant to be public performances in some way?
We don't know. There are a bunch of different theories about that. Some people suggest that they're written to be rhetorical exercises in the school, and we have lots of evidence of similar sorts of things, these kind of comparisons being used in the school that way. Certainly the crises are rhetorical exercises that are used in the school too. I don't know of any evidence that we have that Plutarch's lives were actually used that way. Yes.
I used to teach the lives many years ago, and we would have debates in class based on exactly what you're getting at. And I didn't subject them to any votes, but polls. But it was an excellent way to get students thinking about the concrete, philosophizing about the political things, I guess you might say. So that's the orientation I came to this from, and why I was so excited to hear your talk and enjoyed it so much. I had forgotten all about the section in the Lycurgus about this city philosophizing. And so could you say a little bit more about what you think that means? Because you went through it a little quickly, and there seemed to be some sort of natural background to that. But then I've heard you say, no, this is radically political. And there's not an assent to political things as an entree to philosophy.
So in Berkeley, I think what he means is that in Sparta, people love reflecting and debating about human character, right? So they love wisdom in that sense, and they understand it very precisely. You know, they're constantly discriminating among different people. This question that you put to your students, and actually the first class I took on Plutarch did the same thing. We keep a scorecard in the synchrises, right? And say, like, that's a point for Numa, right? That's a point for Lycurgus, and try to see, like, who won at the end, it was Nathan Tarkov's idea, not my own. It's a really good way of approaching it. It's that kind of, like, judgment that I think Plutarch presents the Spartans as making. And so the kind of wisdom you can imagine, at the end of this pursuit of wisdom would be like perfect knowledge of the human soul as it expresses itself in politics. And his claim, seems to be something like that doesn't require you to understand the human soul's longing for anything other than politics. And that's the kind of, to my mind, the kind of radical and interesting way of distinguishing him from tradition of his party.
So it's really complete, completely satisfying there.
Yeah. As I mean, the problems that arise from that aren't really challenges from philosophers from the outside. I mean, by and large in the lives, the philosophers don't cut, in my view, a very impressive figure. I mean, they're always trying to educate statesmen and usually failing, right? And usually failing. So like Aristotle and Alexander is a story of a failed education on my readings. So I also find that Socrates works that way. Plato and Dionysius works that way in spades. I mean, there are all these problems right there. The problems that arise, though, are kind of internal to someone who loves honor and wants to, be praised by everybody. So like in the case of Agesilaus, is a really good example. A lot of the problems in Agesilaus, for the way Plutarch tells it, have to do with the question of the honor group. Whose praise do you want? Do you want just Spartans? In the great moment of Agesilaus' life, when he goes back to Sparta, he suggests that yes, he is oriented fundamentally by city and couldn't care less what everyone outside of Sparta thinks of. But it gives him this great rivalry. And the Greek is a word that sort of likes to contrast and sometimes pair with philotony, it was philonikia, right? A kind of love of victory or strife, something like that. With Thebes, with the city of Thebes, because Thebes interferes in different ways with this great Pan-Hellenic project that Agesilaus assumes himself to be leading, right? And so he makes all sorts of mistakes in judgment because he wants to show that he's superior to Thebes, not for the sake of the Spartans' approval, but for the sake of the Greeks' approval. So we see in Agesilaus' life a really nice way, the tension between Sparta's identity as a city and its identity as a Greek city. And that ends up being one of the main causes of the collapse of Sparta.
I was just struck by your image of Lycurgus looking back at the city, as a city philosophizing, from the standpoint of someone 800-900 years later, when that city has become a backwater, it's nothing.
Yeah.
In other words, you're philosophizing about these very ephemeral things, and if your attachment is to that, is that ultimately satisfying? Or does that require a kind of...
I don't know if Plutarch understands them to be ephemeral.
Uh-huh.
Let me give you two ways of making that. I just object to Sparta. First, in Lycurgus, in the section where he's talking about how Lycurgus thinks about pain, how to overcome it by democratic means, he says, you can believe all of this because I myself have been to Sparta and have seen these whipping rituals they do by the temple, right? And as best we can tell, this means that the Spartan boys would hold on to a post, right? They'd be whipped until there was one guy left standing and he'd win, right? And the Spartan boys would die, But what's so interesting about that is, Plutarch knows that Sparta is a tourist trap, under Rome. I mean, he's aware of that, right? And yet, he wants to appeal to this practice as if it's been, held from Lycurgus Sparta, and you can believe this happens. So what do we make of that, right? One of the things you might say, there's a very complicated kind of play on Sparta as military Disneyland versus the Sparta he's praising, and that's probably right too. But I think actually there's a way of taking it seriously, which is to say, look, even if in military Disneyland, kids are capable of this, right? You can believe all of these fantastic stories about the boy having his guts eaten by a fox and all the rest of it, right? All the gruesome stuff that might seem fantastical. But if you can do it in Disneyland, you can do it, right? That's easy to put there. So that's one. The second argument is the way that Plutarch ends the Spartan last, and one of the arguments of my book is that, it's not only it doesn't only make sense to speak of individual lives of Plutarch, but in the case of Athens, Rome, and Sparta, he sets up a kind of life of the city that has a beginning, a middle, and an end, right? In the way that the birth, peak and death in the individual lives. But the way he does that in Sparta's case, of course, is ended with Agis and Cleomenes, who are these guys who in a totally corrupt Sparta actually get the Lycurgan regime going again, however briefly. And Plutarch really admires them, I think, for doing that, it doesn't ultimately work. So there's something about Spartan laws that seems like a permanent possibility. And I'm not sure also that the kind of qualities of the soul that are revealed internal to Sparta are in some sense ephemeral too. I mean, if a great Spartan who's incapable of those characters would write a treatise, maybe it would still be relevant.
How do you, some basic questions, I can't quite picture how one would investigate what is political without at some point having to go beyond it or having to find some standard for, I don't know, what even, what virtue would be or how you order it, the different virtues. I mean, everything from Plato that you know very well, how would that even work if you say, it remains entirely within this framework, which according to Plato points beyond it in itself. There has to be, how do Spartans evaluate that their city actually is a good city if there's no way of actually going beyond Sparta? You say, well, actually, I guess Laws does in a way because he wants the approval of all the Greeks, which seems to already imply that there's something deficient about Sparta, or that maybe, but that always means that you can't remain within that horizon, or you can't know that your city is the best kind of city unless you ask questions that go beyond it, and then you might not require return to your city.
Look, I mean, you must be right in some way about describing like why Aeschylus like wants the praise of Greeks, right? I mean, that is right, that historically speaking, you know, the Spartans want to know about in other cities. And, you know, in the Moralia, there's a dialogue where Plutarch presents his characters, these two Spartans who have just made a world tour, like visiting all of these different sites, you know, around the empire. So, you know, this is the kind of end of it. You know, just chronologically in this work, say the Spartans were globetrotters, right? And they're really trying to see everything that happened. I think the interesting question that Lycurgus presents us with is the one, like, is that necessarily so? Right? I mean, is it the case that it would be impossible to satisfy kind of human desire, the human desire for wisdom, on the level of the city? And, you know, I think I might not be totally persuaded by Plutarch's account of this. I mean, sometimes I think, you know, Plato's probably right about this. But I think the interesting like possibility he raises is whether what we ultimately desire to know is human nature, right, as opposed to anything other than human nature. And whether, if you set up contests the right way, and maybe you had a sufficient variety of characters internal to the city, because like, that are better and worse, and they're all, you know, sorts of slayers and has those and so on. You know, whether you could illuminate the human phenomenon sufficiently through that.
But how would that even begin to work? I mean, if you form everybody from, you only see human nature in light of certain tests or standards that are prescribed by the city. You could say have the measure of pain or something, but I mean, who actually say would be a better thinker, or who, but it's the phenomena that have to do with, that only come to light in terms of when lawfulness breaks down, or how, you know, the whole variety of excellence, or even the question of, that there would be, that can come to light in the same way. If you don't have philosophy proper, how can you say, we can begin to investigate human nature? If you can't investigate the soul apart from a politically manifested soul, then how can you know about the soul? If you can't have transpolitical virtue, how can you know the set of virtues? It's a weird thing.
I think kind of like on the superficial level of the question, like, you know, do you have to like have experience of different human types in order to philosophize? Like, I don't think that's necessarily the case. And I think even like examining like how Plato presents Socrates, I mean, you know, how much human diversity is there? We don't see Socrates traveling around to different countries, you know, exploring the world or anything like that. I mean, it seems to be the case that the variety in Athens is sufficient for him to articulate the human phenomenon, you know, and when examined in the right way, and put in the right kind of context. The other question of how would you even like know the political or the human soul if you didn't know something other than the political, right? I think is a really good question. In Sparta, you see things below the political, but nothing above the political. I mean, you do have, you know, slaves, you have, you have women who are in this kind of marginal status, kind of outside the political, but playing a very important supportive role for it. The only thing you don't have is above the political. And so, you know, so the argument must be something like, if that's sufficient to do it. That's an inadequate answer to you, but that's, I think, yeah, that's the other way.
How would Plutarch respond to an argument that became common in modern times, namely that the kind of virtue or ambition that he presents ultimately destroys the city and leads to the empire because it can't be contained by the city? It wasn't in Athens, and of course eventually it wasn't in Rome, and Rome was successful.
I think he wants to say that it's not necessarily so. That's why I take to be the theoretical claim of Lycurgus.
In Sparta, so how does he compare Sparta, where it was contained, and Rome, where it wasn't?
Yeah, well, Rome from the get-go, from the Romulus, is about acquiring and winning honor in that way. And this is the kind of the ironic outcome of the Numa, too. I mean, because as Plutarch presents Numa, he's this, he's a philosopher king. And what that ends up meaning, within this radically political horizon, is he's someone who seems to be appealing to the gods in a way that's totally incomprehensible to everyone around him, and for whom, right, for these Roman citizens, that's a source of authority. Right? He's so confusing that he has to be believed by everybody. Right? He's a bit like that guy from it was in Diocese from the end of Herodotus I, you know, the kind of the monarch of the Medes who builds that giant temple, a castle, and like slowly recedes into the middle of it until the point where he's obeyed by everyone because no one's ever seen him. You know? Like, it's something like that dynamic. But that doesn't end up lasting, right? That, right away after Numa, they revert to the Romulan type. And the only thing that remains behind is Numa's ability to fuse together the Sabines and the Romans, the two ethnicities that have been born, right? So I think on Plutarch's understanding, Rome is from the beginning an imperial city that is capable of fusing into one people all these different people it encounters. And that's the essential kind of like, it's really the nature, I guess, of Rome, right, from the get-go. So why it is that political ambition transcends the city's boundaries in the Roman case is in a way that's not a question you can ask because it's of the essence of the thing that is transcending boundaries. The Athenian case is more interesting. So what's Plutarch's answer on that? In the Athenian case, it's a similar sort of story about a failed attempt to confine. But it's not even really an attempt to confine in this case, because Solon, he criticizes Solon for not doing what Lycurgus did in terms of trying to eliminate these acquisitive passions, and instead, you know, allowing them through, like not equalizing property and all the rest of this. So I think probably in the Athenian case, there's something like a kind of modified version of Rome. And the real exception is Lycurgus.
Well, Sparta was the only city that really stayed a city.
I have a question about commemoration. But first, Machiavelli, you mentioned Machiavelli. He calls Plutarch a gravissimo scrittore, a very grave writer.
That's nice.
Is that a compliment?
I mean, well, I was going to ask you.
Yeah. Well, because gravity is not always the highest virtue. But it seems to me that a possible beginning answer to the question about philosophy is that Plutarch invites and instructs admiration. And how different that is. So his mantra, his way of looking at things, is through timocracy, which you said, not through democracy. So how different that is from today, where of course in moral philosophy would never begin with people who are to be admired. But he instructs it by getting you to understand. And so Aristotle makes a distinction between prizing and praising. And prizing is beyond praising. But Plutarch seems to want to show you how to praise with the people that you prize. And then, and from a human point of view, too. Not so he is, in a way, anti-hero, I suggest. Anti-heroic, because he shows that heroes aren't gods or don't play with gods, but they're political types who deal with the problems that you have when you love honor, which is what most people admire, even more in a very low manifestation, such as we see today.
I agree with that approach to the argument. That's right. Yeah, so he's teaching him how to admire and to. What's interesting, though, for me, as you were saying, you're right on the one hand that he wants to show us that these great figures who are, more prone to admire are not gods, and that's extremely important. Right? On the other hand, he's very forgiving of their association with gods, which is an interesting element of his thought. So Numa is, comes up in Alexander and Caesar in different ways too, but the Numa is a really interesting case of this, because Numa claims to have, in traditions we have, he tells it, that he had this kind of affair with a goddess, out in the woods, go hang some time with the goddess. And when Numa starts to use the gods in his lawgiving, Plutarch gives us the kind of, cynical, and Hobbesian like account of this, which is that he doesn't have sufficient power on his own, so he uses the fear of the gods in order to win initial obedience to his laws. But he also gives us this other account, which says that actually, the Romans thinking that Numa has this divine like consort is one way they express their admiration for him. Right, that he, of course, he's loved by gods because he's an amazingly virtuous, admirable individual. And he seems to want to, if not encourage, at least tolerate that way of thinking about great individuals and gods. On the other hand, he's explaining it to his readers, right? And so that's not to say that, yes, they were, affiliated in this way with the gods, but this is how we should understand it, as a variety of admiration.
Hugh, thanks. I was struck with your discussion of Lycurgus parallelizing Jews in these contexts. That's a way in which creative people seem like you're kind of suggesting that the parallelizing and the encouraging people that think approach kind of virtue that way is maybe above all what he has in mind. Now that put me in mind of something Strauss says somewhere, I think it might have been in the Hegel 65 class, that in Plutarch, and so the context, if I remember right, of Hegel kind of disparaging the Romans vis-a-vis the Greeks, and Strauss says, if you look at Plutarch at the comparisons, if you look at the individual lives, the Greeks always look better.
Yeah.
If you look at the comparisons, he hedges. So the comparisons make it seem more equal or ambiguous. And I guess that seems roughly right. Does that?
I think there are plenty of cases where the Romans more than hold their own against the Greeks.
Yeah. Well, I was going to ask how that fits with the thought that the parallelizing is really his chief endeavor, and it sounds like you're skeptical, Strauss.
There are actual post-colonial approaches to Plutarch that take that line and say that what he's trying to do is not only show that the Greeks are equal, but that they are superior on this plane that the Romans previously seemed to own, this is my political action, right? And what's more, Plutarch, when he's using, when he's urging us to evaluate their characters, is using terms from Greek political thought, by and large, right, and ethical tradition and so on, which is to say that, he's kind of occupying the cultural, conceptual categories, right, and exerting power over the Romans in that way. To my mind, that's not a particularly fruitful way of reading Plutarch, because he seems to, it seems important to his project that I read it, and it's important to the way it's presented through Lycurgus too, that there's a kind of equality between the two, where you're left with a genuinely difficult decision at the end. And it's only out of that difficulty, I think, that you really can kind of engage in the reflection, comparison, and actually learn something that may be of philosophical interest to you from doing that. So. Yeah, and also, I don't know exactly what, the only actually pair that I can think of where it seems like Plutarch kind of, decides pretty clearly on one and the other in the Greek is the Lycurgus Numa, where he ends up criticizing Lycurgus for things in Synchresis that are serious critiques. They're critiques he's refuted in one way or another in the life of Lycurgus, and they're always made as conditional critiques, even in the Synchresis. But that's it, and other than that, they seem pretty even-handed to me.
I think Strauss's thought was that he had to be more careful about criticizing Romans and about criticizing Greeks, obviously.
Yeah, that might be.
Thank you. I just wanted to press you a little bit more on some of the things you've been talking about, especially love of honor, and especially whether ultimately Plutarch thinks the most admirable type of human being is moved by love of honor. I mean, you've stressed that